I haven't done anything like this before, so bear with me. But I figured that Tableau has a pretty good community about like visual painting and all that stuff. But I don't find much with the server community, so I'm kind of excited to just open up a forum for like-minded folks like us to communicate and share tips and spread knowledge. So with that, let's dive into what you're here for tonight. We're gonna talk about scaling Tableau at Netflix. And really, this is about how we made Tableau enterprise tool here. Format will be pretty simple. I manage the Tableau platform. I'm in charge of that. Kat is a user of the Tableau platform. I'm going to talk about how we made the platform awesome for people like her to use. I think we had some comment from the audience. Can you hear me now? No? Maybe I should mic up. Or maybe I should just talk louder?
Yeah,
it's
better.
Okay. Sounds good. All right. Cool. Well, let's get started. So at Netflix, for the last couple of years now, we've been using Tableau, and we've gone through various phases here. We initially started using Tableau desktop. And so there may be like a handful of users, 15 or so. And then, we, started an investment into, Tableau server. So we got a larger audience. And then eventually, recently, we grew into a full-fledged Tableau enterprise implementation. and it's become a core part of our data platform since then. So I'm going to walk you through the journey of how that happened. And the idea is hopefully that you'll learn a few things along the way on how we did stuff that may be applicable to you. So I guess first question is, how many people are managing Tableau server here? Okay. How many people are like doing this in their first year? Okay. All right, cool. So hopefully you'll learn something. Who's a like a advanced server person? Okay. Hopefully we'll have something for you. But if not, well, we can follow up and talk about more interesting stuff. anyway, so the topics that we'll hit tonight, scaling Tableau at Netflix, right? So how we scaled our user base, how it grew from a handful of users to about 1,500 at this point. How we scale the infrastructure to support that user base. Some of the engineering we did to fill in some product gaps that we felt wasn't quite where we wanted Tableau to be. So, so there's a disconnect between our expectations and what we wanted the product to do. So we'll go over some of the things that we developed here to work around that. And also, we have a lot of data, so I'm going to talk about how we deal with big data and scale past that. So, and just to be clear, this is not scaling to very large data sets in Tableau. It's more about connecting to the various big data sources that are sort of cutting edge and Tableau doesn't really have great support for. So with that, let's start from the beginning. In 2011, we got a demo from Tableau sales reps, and so we had a we had some time to decompress after the demo. We thought amongst ourselves, you know, what do you think about Tableau? And I have some quotes, you know, like, but the main gist is that people kind of liked it. Thought it was, you know, beautiful or great visualizations, but just weren't really sure how to use it in the sense that it wasn't really solving like a problem that we had. It was kind of doing something maybe a little bit prettier. So our very first challenge was to decide, you know, how do we use Tableau here? We looked through our reporting solutions. Typically, people want to send emails, and then they want to have something to interact with online. There's a third class of users who want to just dive deep into the data. And we thought that Tableau was a great use case for that. We already had solutions for the other two use cases, so we didn't really want to mess with that. It's working pretty well for us. And so we stuck with that decision for pretty much 2012, for one a whole year. And so this is a picture of our reporting platform landscape in 2012. We sort of had this divide where, you know, on the left hand side, we have enterprise tools that, you know, dish out the emails and serve up the interactive visualizations. And on the right-hand side, we have like interactive tools that allow you to dive into data, pivot, slice, filter, and all that stuff. We kind of slotted Tableau's use case in into that use case for most of that year. The following year, in 2013, we attended a Tableau roadshow. This is when Tableau 8 came out. And long story short, I found a few items, or I guess technical features of Tableau that I really liked, and started to play around with it. And at the roadshow, I was able to kind of learn how to use Tableau, download a server component, and solve a problem that I'd been working on for a few days, all in span of like 30 minutes. So I figured, you know, if I could save that amount of time, like I thought, you know, how much time could developers here at Netflix save? So there's definitely some potential for some potential for use here that would be good for our data development teams. We all kind of know how the story ends. Tableau was kind of successful here. That's why you're all here. I just figured we'd walk through some of the milestones of getting there, from inception of concept to like full platform integration. So I've outlined four milestones that we've achieved. So the first was to pick a proof of concept to make sure that Tableau was going to meet a use case and was going to be useful here. The second milestone was discipline what I call gap engineering, which is basically a tool sort of does what you wanted to do, doesn't quite meet your expectations, and so you engineer something to fill that gap. So we have a couple of examples of what we did there. Onboarding, that was important. It's definitely not a if you build it, they will come type of situation. We definitely made efforts to build a community around Tableau and Netflix. And so I'll walk you through like the different components there. And then platform integration, which is sort of the cherry on top of, we have Tableau implemented here, but what can we do to make it more of a, like elevate it to a first class citizen, and just overall make things easy to use. So step one was to basically get a guinea pig, right? We wanted a POC of a working example of how Tableau would be used here. And some of the key features of what I looked for in a POC was we didn't want it to be highly visible. Like we didn't want to take on like our weekly executive staff emails. you know, and all the baggage that would come from like trying to make that usable. At the same time, we didn't want it to be an academic exercise, so we didn't want something to be just created and not be useful. Third, we didn't want any complicated dependencies, so I kind of wanted to own the full solution end-to-end, so I didn't have to depend on other teams, or I wasn't blocked waiting for, you know, people to create a data workflow or anything like that. And then lastly, I didn't want an existing solution. I didn't want that because, you know, if you run into maybe some roadblocks in Tableau, then it's really easy to fall back on what you're using, right? Also, it's kind of pointless to solve something that's already solved. Sherlock, it was our first Tableau server viz. And basically what it was, analysis on Hadoop metrics. So Hadoop, we use Hadoop for big data processing. This just shows a graph of like the number of nodes that were active throughout time on an hourly basis, or sorry, on a 5-minute basis. There's actually a lot of data points that are rendered here, which gave some of our other tools some trouble in terms of, you know, interacting with it quickly. And so, you know, right out the gate, Tableau was useful in that aspect, being able to interact with, you know, hundreds of thousands of data points relatively quickly. It was not highly visible, so only the Hadoop administrative team would look at this. It wasn't an academic exercise. It was actually so useful that it was referenced in our Netflix tech blog. So I have a link to that here on the bottom right. It wasn't super complicated in terms of dependencies. We did have to make some API calls to get some metrics, but they were all put into a MySQL database, and this is just sitting on top of one of those tables. And it was not an existing solution. So it was definitely something that was needed for capacity planning, determining like how many Hadoop resources we needed. And it also helped this team to track down specific users who weren't using the platform optimally. It served a lot of purposes it served this purpose for a good year or so. The beauty of this was that, you know, like we kind of had like a small scale Tableau shop and serving about 15 to 20 users was the size of this team. We were able to have this set up for about a year and a half to kind of study Tableau, understand how to develop in it, understand its quirks and how to work around that type of stuff. So 1.5 years was pretty luxurious to have kind of all to ourselves to learn this. let's see, anything else I want to say? Okay. just to summarize this milestone progression, we had a proof of concept, it was successful, and we deployed it out in production. So we were able to shift from a desktop-only analyst solution to client-server architecture, where a developer could share his work with other groups of people. The next milestone that we met was filling in gaps, and I've extracted two key gaps that I felt was really slowing down our overall adoption here. Those items were server account management and emailing. I'll walk through the details of that through the next slides. So server account management. Imagine like you got a link from someone who was like, hey, check out this metric, it's going off the charts for this dimension, right? You click on it and then you get this error message. Authentication failed. Unable to authenticate user. This was the most annoying screen I saw for like, in so many ways, it was just a useless message. So let me tell you why I hate this screen. Unable to authenticate user. What user? Please try again. Contact your administrator. Okay, we're a company of like thousands of people. Like, who's the administrator? Who would I contact? And then to try again, click here. Like, why would I try to something that doesn't work again? This was beyond me. I went back and forth with Tableau. It's like, dude, can you like fix this? Or like, what can we do? Like, can we purchase like an all-you-can-eat license plan and kind of go by honor system? I tried so many things. Eventually, we found a solution with Node.js and the REST API from Tableau. Node.js is a web server. The web server technology doesn't really matter. Node.js is sort of the in-style thing, so we just went with that. The REST API was something that allowed us to programmatically talk to the Tableau server and create users. And so we did a little bit of hacking around, but we eventually got to this method, where if you saw a no account error screen, we would redirect you to the signup flow, which would identify you, authenticate you, and if all was good, we would add you to the Tableau system. And then once you're added, then we would redirect you back to where you came from. So that was problem number one. Problem number two was emailing. I think a lot of people are attracted to Tableau for its interactive capabilities. But there are definitely classes of users who just don't want to be in tools. They just want answers, right? So, and you wouldn't want to send them into Tableau server, create an account, navigate to your dashboard just to click this subscribe. So the second thing we wanted to address was emailing. Second of all, I think this wasn't even here when we evaluated. It was like, I think we were looking at Tableau 6.1. That's sort of moot. We're able to take control of the emailing solution with Tableau and something called tab command, which is Tableau's command line interface, which allows you to do a bunch of stuff. So Python, we use it for its ability to, there's a library that allows you to construct emails. So like, the to, the from, the subject header, the email body, attachments, all that stuff. And then we use tab command to, there's a command in there that allows you to export a visualization. So you can export it as an image, for instance, and then put it in the email body. We also gave our users the capability to export as a PDF and attach it to the email. We also added a couple extra things. So we were able to personalize emails by sending in filters to the visualization. So different people on the distribution list can get different views of the data, basically the same visualization but filtered. We were able to stitch together emails with multiple views embedded into the email. So by taking control of this solution, we were able to just kind of add more capabilities as we needed. To summarize this milestone progression, we have basically all we added was a way to send emails and a way to sign up. Those are pretty straightforward. So we were able to set ourselves up to do a little bit more. Basically, the main functions of what we wanted out of a reporting solution. So able to send emails, able to send, able to interactively interact with dashboards, and also to do use Tableau to do analysis. Okay, so the third milestone we tackled was onboarding. And how we went about doing this was, well, first we needed to train ourselves in how to use Tableau. So when we initially started this, no one knew anything about Tableau. From my team's perspective, we were able to use that year and a half where, not many people were using it, to kind of train ourselves and gain a lot of knowledge within that time frame. When we were ready to roll out Tableau to other folks, with the gaps engineered and sign up and email and all that stuff, we set up basically these things called lunch and learns, which was, we brought some guy from Tableau who really knew his stuff and just kind of had a session to go over basic features on how to do stuff. We did this for various groups, various data groups within Netflix. And by the time that was done, we were all trained up. We sort of were on equal footing. We knew the basics of how to use Tableau. And so that allowed people to get into the tool and start using it and start playing around with it. The second thing we did was set up a Tableau user group that was internal to Netflix. So this is more of a community for people who have development questions and don't know how to do this, and then you just blast out a question. Someone is helpful and answers your question. It's not unlike the knowledge forums that you see online. Similar questions to that. You can always find an answer. And there are a lot of people who are using Tableau in very strange ways. Kind of stretching it to its limits. I'm not in Tableau every day. I'm kind of engineering around Tableau. I'm not the best person to answer these questions. There's a self-sufficient group that, just helps each other out here. And then the third group that we have here is a strategy group. And we meet on a bi-weekly basis. This is sort of a group that is kind of dedicated to making Tableau work better, figuring out how to extract the most use of Tableau that we can at Netflix. So that's sort of also administrators and stakeholders meeting together and kind of working through issues, that type of stuff. And the bottom half of this slide is saying you don't have to have these components to onboard, right? But I think to sort of generalize what we've done here, we've set up a community for learning, a community for developing Tableau, and then a community for innovating the implementation here. So with that, we have a pretty decent platform here. We've got a Tableau community around that, and it's starting to look like a pretty full ecosystem. And the last thing that we did was to integrate it further into our overall platform. And so some of the things that we wanted to address or that we tackled initially are user experience. So at this point, we're a team that manages four different reporting tools, right? So each one has its own navigation interface. It becomes hard to traverse through each different interface and learn the different interfaces as a developer and especially as a user. And so we wanted to address that. And then getting connected to big data. So that was a challenge for us. And so I'll go into a little bit more detail here. Reportal is, it's a play on words, it's report portal. This is what we use to address the user experience situation. So basically, and the key components of this service is there's a discovery service which allows you to come to an interface and just kind of search for a report. And so made it easy to kind of just have one place to go to look for reports, regardless of whether it was in Tableau, whether it was in another BI tool, things like that. And then we had another feature which allowed you to basically curate a landing page or create like a personal page based on all these different assets. Let me tell you how it works. It's pretty straightforward. So we have, you know, on the left-hand side, like our different reporting tools. And each tool has like some kind of repository of assets, right? We start to think of these as just assets. But these tools have like a, you know, listing of all the reports, like who owns it, where it's located, and all that stuff. So all we did was we extracted that that information into a central catalog. It could be anything. We chose to use just the MySQL database. And along with that, we also extracted some stats on like who was using it, you know, how many unique users are hitting, you know, whatever report, or how many hits a report is getting. And that kind of helped us to understand, like, you know, what are the popular reports? What are people actually looking at? Like when I search for how many subscribers Netflix has, which report is it that they're using? Because there's like probably like 10 or 20 different permutations of that report. So we have all that information in a database, and all you do is basically slap a UI on top of that, right? So that's what we did there. The second pain point for us was getting connected to big data. So Tableau works really well with relational databases, like MySQL I mentioned. We use Teradata. I know people use Vertica, and there's also Redshift, which we're also starting to use. All these relational databases are pretty, you know, plug and play with Tableau. We have a lot of data that we need to analyze. And so we also have a different class of data stores to work with, like these larger volumes of data. I'll just go over them right now. The first is Presto, which was developed by Facebook. It's a pretty, you know, fast engine to query large sets of data. The second one we have is Hive, which is an interface on top of Hadoop. And then the third one is sort of like a newer interface that's similar to Hive that's coming up. That's slowly gaining some traction here. The problem with these data sources is that it's not really well supported by BI tools. Like each time something new comes out in big data space, like there's always something new coming out. You're always sort of dealing with cutting edge tools there. And so it's going to take a while for BI tools to catch up with getting connected to those things and integrated. But each time these tools came up, we, you know, work with like other teams to create ODBC drivers just so that these BI tools could talk to it, and so we could create reports on top of it. But even then, we were finding a lot of errors with these ODBC tools. And I've listed out a few of them below, but basically we took a long, hard look at what we were doing here, and we decided to shift strategies. What we ended up doing was leveraging the Tableau SDK, which consists of the Extract API and a REST API. The Extract API allows us to create Tableau data extracts, which, if you're not familiar with what an extract is you could think of it as a report cache. And then the REST API allows us to publish these objects onto the server. We also used it, as I mentioned earlier, to add users onto the server. So with that, we were able to, backing up. We also looked at like all the different visualizations on our Tableau server and realized that 99% of them were using Tableau data extracts. Like there were no visualizations that were live connected to a data source. And so to me, that was like, okay, you're pushing data into some intermediate format so you can get it into a Tableau format. That was just kind of inefficient, right? So we decided, hey, let's streamline this whole thing so it's easy to move data directly into the Tableau server. So long story short, we used the Tableau API. We also used our own internal API to query this data. We packaged it up into a Tableau native format and then uploaded it onto the server, which then you could connect your visualization directly to. and so that really smoothed out the workflow for getting Tableau connected to our big data sets. So to summarize, we brought in Tableau server, we created infrastructure around Tableau server, like report portal and all those big data workflows. Data prepping utilities is what I kind of slotted those things into here in this picture. We also engineered gaps. So we have our own email solution, we have our own sign up solution. So we can be hands off with adding users onto the system. And then we have a pretty good community around the Tableau ecosystem with these main components. And then that's pretty much how Tableau became a core part of our data platform. And with that, I'm going to turn this over to Kat, who's going to talk about how to use Tableau, how to create a cool visualization.
Thank you, Albert. So my name is Kat. I'm a part of data engineering and analytics team at Netflix. I use Tableau, I'm not an admin, and I want to share a report that I built for our stakeholders and some of the limitations that we ran into and some of the workarounds that we've implemented to work around that. So first, the team that I belong to, we call ourselves DEA Marketing. We specifically serve our marketing stakeholders, and we deal with a lot of advertising data across various advertising platforms outside of Netflix. And we integrated in-house and then blended with internal data to derive some insights and analysis and come up with actionable recommendations for our users. Our team structure is in two different sub-teams. One is core marketing and the other one is social listening. So core marketing is a sub-team that does a lot of ingestion of huge volumes of data from external vendors, as well as integration into in-house Netflix structure, and then deriving insights from the data and providing reports and dashboards to our users. And then social listening is a team that does social media analytics. We do some PR storytelling, and we provide data for our PR team to publish stories about Netflix. It is very exciting to work for the marketing team or for the marketing stakeholders at Netflix, because our goal is to promote the original content that's available out there. And I'm sure a lot of you know these movies and shows, and that's the job that our marketing team does. We also spend about $1 billion a year on marketing, so it's a pretty important business area for the whole company. When it comes down to marketing objectives, we really have three. First one is to create excitement about our content, then to motivate people to sign up, and essentially to watch that content. And with that, our team built a marketing executive dashboard to kind of do a temperature check on how we're doing against these objectives. And so this dashboard shows how active running campaigns perform against the benchmarks. And today I want to actually do a live demo of the report that I built. Okay. So this is how it looks right now. Let's pretend that there are five different titles that we're trying to analyze and five different measures going across. And what we're trying to do here is to compare active titles against each other, as well as have a holistic view of one title with the major key performance indicators. And the visualization choices that we chose here are, for the most part, straight out of the box from Tableau, with a couple of tweaks and workarounds that I will talk about. And this is a marketing dashboard, so we wanted to make it fun and easy to read. And this is meant for our CMO. So it's a very high level analysis of what's going on with marketing today. So the first kind of trick that I want to share is this information button that you see on the top left corner. Upon hover over, you get directions on how to use this dashboard. You get definitions of measures. You can enter business logic, formulas, or maybe some external links for additional information. And this is done for the purposes of saving space. I see a lot of dashboards with instructions either in the footnotes or at the top of the page, or maybe even on a different tab. And the users have to kind of click between different tabs, and we didn't want our users to do that. And instead to have a quick reference point to know what it is that they're looking at. And this is actually a very easy hack. And I can demo how it's done. So basically I have a separate sheet that I called info button, and I'm using a shape mark here, and I mapped it to a custom saved image that is saved on the server local, on the desktop locally. So all I can do here is go to shapes and save that image locally in my KPI folder within my Tableau repository, and then map it to the image on the sheet. And then in the tooltip, I will add directions and information on how to use the dashboard. So it's very easy to accomplish without any special coding or JavaScript or anything like that. Let me remove this. So the second hack that I have on this dashboard is the donut chart. Now, I know pie charts, donut charts are very controversial in the business intelligence world, to use them or not to use them. But if you were to use them, they're very, very easy to create. A donut chart is not available by default in Tableau. And what we've actually done here is we laid over a circle on top of a pie chart. And I can demonstrate how to do it very quickly. So we can create like a dummy metric. It doesn't really matter what it is or what its value is. I will call it dummy, and I will have its value 0. Then I will drag it to the column twice, and I will create a dual axis. And by default, Tableau will create some type of visualization that it thinks is the most appropriate for this use case. However, I want to change it to a donut chart. So in my first column, I will select a pie, and I will play with its size to make it bigger. And the second column I will leave as a circle. I will just change its color to like white. So now it looks like a donut chart. And then I will perform typical steps that you would do with a pie chart to you know, show the distribution. So I can drag measure values to the angle. And let's select measure 2 and measure 2 left to hit the target. And then I will color this pie chart by the measure names. Now what's on the bisque is a quick donut chart available for usage. And then if you want to know some information about, say, value of measure two, you can drag it to the tool, to the label, and you can play with its location. You can increase its size and so forth. So again, with the tools that Tableau provides out of the box and a little bit of play around, it's possible to create something like this very quickly. The third hack or workaround that I have in this dashboard is actually what Tableau calls viz within the viz. It's if you were to hover over a specific column or a chart, you'd want to know more information about it. And I know that Tableau is coming up with this kind of out-of-the-box functionality in the next releases, but it's not available yet. And for now, this is the only possible visualization that I could do. For example, I can do a time series or a map for now, but it will be available essentially when Tableau comes out with it. So the way I'm accomplishing this distribution is by creating four different measures and coloring them in different colors. So if I look at my tooltip, I have four lines in here with different colors. And to accomplish this, I create four different measures and then I drag them onto the tooltip. First measure that I create is basically percentage share to the total, percentage contribution. And in the end, they all sum up to 100%. And then basically from that share, I create this metric that I call percent share bar. And it looks kind of funky, but it does the job. So what we're doing here is actually using Tableau's trimming functionality. I'm doing a left trimming of a string specified by the rounding number that is percentage contribution to total. And this character here is actually a square that you can copy and paste anywhere. And you can copy and paste it many, many times. Then you drag this measure onto the tooltip, and what it looks like is like a bar, but in fact it's many different squares, you know, next to each other. So this is another hack that we found. We have a second tab in our dashboard that accomplishes a comparison of active campaigns across multiple different regions. And we chose this visualization in order to be able to do a quick check to see outliers and spot any trends with the titles that are popping out or underperforming, for example. And within this visualization, we wanted to be able to change different metrics that we're comparing. So we have a measure selector on the top left. And for the demo, I picked percentage measure and then a dollar measure. So when I choose the dollar, my viz will change. And the trick here is, if you notice, when I pick percentage measure, my y-axis is showing percentages. But when I select dollar measure, it changes to billions of dollars. Again, this is also a hack because today there's no dynamic formatting available in Tableau. And we had to get creative with it. I know that there are many different workarounds to solve this problem. For example, some people do counting of a number of characters in a string, and then they enter a comma to separate thousands and so forth. But what we've done here is actually hiding and compressing multiple sheets. So for the user, it's not really obvious, you know, that there is a sheet swapping going on. So right now I'm looking at percentage measure sheet that is expanded. However, what's not visible is that there's something in front of it, and there are two more sheets that are behind it. And when I change it to percentage measure, the first sheet that was hidden gets expanded, and then I have three sheets that get hidden.
You can set it to the drop down there, something?
Yes.
Click on the sheet and drop down.
Click on the sheet and drop down?
There's a drop down on the right hand corner.
Yeah. Yep.
So select layer
content. Oh, layer content. Yeah, got it.
There you go.
Right. and this is possible with what's called in Tableau view filters. We basically are using a parameter that we created that has two elements right now, which is percentage measure or dollar measure. We then created a dimension, and we called it select measure filter. And that dimension value is equal to the parameter value. And then we drag this select measure filter onto the filter pane, and we specified what we want to see in that filter. So we only want to see values if percentage measure is selected. If there's anything else selected, I want my sheet to be null. So if I select a different measure, my data will disappear. Another hack or trick in this dashboard is what I call hidden filters. For our users to be able to compare within different regions and then to drill down to country level analysis, we didn't want to put 100 plus countries that Netflix is in on the same biz, because it wouldn't be a pretty picture. So we decided to prompt the users to select within which region they want to analyze the countries. And by that, I mean changing this region to country filter. And then we get this filter pop up out of nowhere that says, within which region do you want to analyze countries? So if I select, for example, macro region 3, I get countries 12 through 25 appearing. And then if I change it back to region, the filter disappears. And again, this is no JavaScript or anything. It's a Tableau trick. This filter is actually always present. We just choose to hide or unhide it based on the selection. And to demonstrate it, I will remove this blank section that I have. And you'll see that if I select country, the filter pops up. And then if I select region, it goes down. And this is possible with also view filters within Tableau. I have this filter cover separate sheet that gets compressed or expanded based on my parameter selection. So right now, there is just a blank space in this sheet. But if I choose country, I will see nothing. So with that, it was a trick to, you know, kind of hide the functionality from the users and not get them confused, but then show it whenever they need it. And these hacks are actually, you know, pretty popular out there, and there are so many solutions for Tableau that these are not the only ones that are possible to use. I myself found Tableau community very friendly, and if you have a question and post your question online, you'll get a million answers. But for our executive dashboard, it has gained a lot of traction, and the users love it. They think it's easy to use, and it definitely meets our use case for marketing. With that, I think I wanted to cover everything that I did. And I think we'll take some questions.
Thanks, Kat. Like I said, people using Tableau in really crazy ways. but yeah, I can field any platform questions. Kat can field any like dashboard visualization questions.
I have a question about the strategic group you had mentioned as part of the onboarding process.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if you could speak to who makes up that group, whether it's primarily Tableau users, or there are any business leaders that aren't Tableau users but help